redeemed a $50,000 cash prize playing Chumba Casino online.
I was only playing for fun, so winning was a dream come true.
Chumba Casino is America's favorite free online social casino. You, too, could have the chance to win life-changing cash prizes. Absolutely anybody could be like Mary. Be like Mary. Log on to ChumbaCasino.com and play for free now. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details. The voice in the preceding commercial was not the actual voice of the winner.
The Fan.
Rally to the Valley. Hashtag Faith Radio.
Thank you.
L.
Hold on to your butt.
All I can say is, wow.
Let's go, everybody. Let's go. Good morning.
I'm a kid, so I call a K-Fan.
From the freezers to the geezers.
Football feet.
There's something wrong with you. Shame on you for saying that.
9 to noon. Hey, get out of there.
How are you doing today?
It's PA, 9 to noon, I'm a fan.
Paul, it's a pleasure to be with you today.
How you doing? How you doing?
Hell yes! He gone! This rule is BS.
Now, producer.
Hey!
52's here on a Thursday. It's a Thursday that feels like a Friday football feast, but, it's Thursday and 52 Radio is in the air. What do you think about that?
Hell yes!
That's what I say.
You gotta be bleeping me!
Got to be bleeping me. It's a Thursday in the neighborhood. The neighborhood being FM 100.3 KFAN. Funky right now.
Send him back to school and teach him what this game is about.
Put those metaphorical flashlights on 9 to noon at FM 100.3 KFAN. Paul Allen, Matt, producer by my side. And here is one of the better linebackers in the history of Minnesota Vikings football. His name is Chad Greenway. Here not only with a big announcement, but to discuss Minnesota Vikings football and National Football League action. And good morning, Mr. Chad Greenway. What's going on with you, my brother?
What is going on, man? It's good to be on a Thursday. It's kind of a nice different vibe. You know, it's training camp, so every day is Friday football feast.
How badly do you miss Charge?
I actually came in on Thursday because of that. I hope he's not listening right now. No, I'm kidding.
You love
Charge. Miss Charge, love Charge. Yeah. I love the angle Charge always brings from a football standpoint, because it's an angle that I never consider. Because he always, it's analytics, it's numbers, yeah. it's
excitable.
It's a different type of fandom that he has.
Yeah.
So he'll see a football, I'm the old school football guy, see it from a wins and losses standpoint. He sees it from a different angle. So you missed that angle.
He, Paul Charchian, the identity of fantasy football in the universe, he takes the devil's advocate approach without being the devil.
Yep.
Yeah, that's about the best way to put it.
And he's consistent about it.
Is there are many who are contrarian to be contrarian, even though they don't completely believe it.
Yep.
Just to like do the opposite guy. So I'm like PA and he'll be DA, the devil's advocate, but he's the devil's advocate without being the devil because he really believes a lot of the things that he says, and it's founded on evidence and statistical equity and statistical wherewithal. So anytime he's bugging me on that for the Friday football feast, I just bring up a defensive player and the whole conversation stops.
And he'll always eat with the, and the here's why.
Yeah.
Because he has a number behind it to like prove his point. Yeah. Like he spent too much time on this topic.
Yeah, he's like, Derrick Henry's going to go for 175 yards against a defense where I can't name any players ever.
But how about that linebacker?
And then, right, and then you just kind of roll down the road with it. Speaking of linebackers, I want to talk about Eric Kendricks a little bit coming up down the road. But there is burgeoning and developing steam at Twin Cities Orthopedics Performance Center, and that's more so than the hot weather in which they've been working to execute their toil. And this started bubbling a little bit before they put on pads, and then they went to shells, then they'll go back to pads. The mental part of it was bubbling in organized team activities through minicamp, and then they chill, then they come back, and it's hot again, and it's bubbling again. In fact, this pot is about to boil over because there are so many people, and the right people, mentioning to me that left tackle Christian Darrisaw is just whooping ass for profit on a daily basis. Now, the one-on-one drills, with which you're very familiar, I've had the opportunity to watch Christian versus Daniil and Christian versus Zadarius and Christian versus DJ and Christian versus the Gopher, the Gopher rookie, Atomawa, and he's holding his ground in very, very competitive fashion. Mm. And that's nothing but good news. And I'm not one that's going to cast my gaze or prognosticate the way of, all right, this is cool, but I ain't going to get too excited because he missed all those games last year.
Right.
So now with Darrisaw on one side and O'Neal doing what O'Neal does, I mean, seriously, it's like when I reference if Darrisaw plays a majority of the games and holds up against the competition, the way we are all watching him against 99 and 55, and then O'Neal plays all the games because that's what he does. I mean, that's a top five tackles tandem in the NFL. And the reference, I believe, would take us back to when you played in 2009 with Bryant McKinney and Phil Loadholt.
Yep.
Now you got HOF Hutch in there too, and Sully could get around the block too. However, when you have a tackles tandem like that, like, what do you think it does to the mental wherewithal or confidence of the quarterback? And good morning.
Good morning. It is everything. I look back to the Eric Fisher L that was taken before the Super Bowl and Patrick Mahomes, and we saw a completely different Mahomes that game.
That's a great
because
example.
he couldn't do what he always had done because Fisher wasn't there.
That game kind of changed who Patrick has become.
100%. You had to become something different, and he wasn't as accurate as he would had typically have been, and it completely changed the game, and they take the L, and we move on. But I think when you have a quarterback like Kirk that we've seen when he has time can be so elite with his accuracy and on time and where he wants to be deliver the football. And when you see him get sped up or you see him have to move or you see him have to kind of shift gears, you see a little bit of a different quarterback. And I think it's fair to say that if you have, as a quarterback, if I know I'm protected on the outsides, right, with these nasty ends that we're going to see every week,
yeah,
and you're practicing against Daniil and Zadarius and you're getting wins and you're at practice and you're able to hold up in a 2-minute and step up in the pocket and throw a ball in the middle of the field,
yeah,
that is everything for a quarterback.
Yeah.
And everything for a play caller. I think that's the one thing is the confidence of the play caller to say, I know I have time to get this play. Mm. And if you do that, and I was like, okay, it's a 3rd and 8. Can we get to that next? Can we get to that next level route? We can because we have these guys.
Right.
And I think when you put the whole thing, I mean, it's exciting. It's the time of year to be excited about everything.
So you think quarterbacks think about that during the course of the game if their left tackle is of the L variety?
I think it'd be absolutely. When you know you're going to get pressure because you've seen it all week in practice or you've seen it from the week before, now you get to that next game and say, okay, coach is going to call this play. I know in the last two times I've seen this play or this type of timing on this play,
yep.
I've been pressured from the left side. I got to move to my right and make a throw, and I'm not as good that way. Whatever you're thinking,
yep.
And even if it's not a conscious thought, it just when because football is so much about repetition, you get so used to that rep that it all of a sudden becomes just innate that you're going to have a little bit more skittish feet and you're going to move to a different spot and not maybe throw from the best plane and all those things kind of work together. But if you know and have the confidence that I'm going to hold up here and just knock this throw down and yeah. Here we go, first down bikes, I think it plays a huge factor.
And see, from when you came into the game in 06 and started playing in 07 after the ACLL, it's whether you're behind the scenes or whether you do what I do, you know, you'll get quick little thoughts
yep.
from those who would know exactly what the answer is. And there's a difference from when you're hearing from one, two, or three people, they can't get by him.
Yep.
They can't get by him. They can't get by him. As opposed to when there's an undrafted cat or a seventh rounder who's jumping out of his skin in yep. training camp. And then it's like, well, this is working really well.
Yep.
But there still is a ceiling, generally speaking, for those individuals. The first rounders with the nice feet don't have.
Right.
You know, it's like the really old school example. I mean, it's like 17, 18, 19, 20 years old. Is the Vikings had a safety from a small Louisiana school named Kyrie Zabert. And in training camp in Fankato, I mean, you know, whether it was Mike Tice or just a person A, B, C, or D, I mean, they were all over this big, beautiful yep. physical specimen. and he was killing it during training camp, but he still wasn't running with the ones, but he was killing it. In the preseason games, he was okay. Well, it didn't work out. I mean, Kyrie's ended up having a few years in the league, maybe even half a decade as kind of a role player, special teams guy. But I've just learned over the years that position coaches or those in the room who end up liking somebody
yep.
that they will want to elevate
yep.
that individual with people who do what I do, even though they don't completely believe it. They're just, you know, and it's born of hope and hashtag faith, and I really yep. hope things work out well for this cat. But when you start getting steamy stuff like they can't get by him
yep.
with a left tackle who was taken in the first round and in his debut in Charlotte, you know, he's playing like 89 plays. They're going to overtime. Hassan Reddick, an accomplished rusher,
yep.
comes flying in and Darrisaw is tired. He's big. And then he dances back and just shoves him off to the side and Cousins goes cold-blooded to KJ and they win the game.
Yep.
So, like, from that debut, you see what the individual can do,
yep.
but then like the next game he plays and he's okay, but then he's out.
Yep.
And then he's like questionable, and then doesn't play. So, you know, because then you get into, and you know this more than anybody, man, but then you get into the, well, does he have the desire to push through
yep.
little things in the second part of the season where we need wins like we need to breathe?
Yeah, I think two good examples is with Darrisaw, you know, coming from a guy who missed his whole first year, is those questions pop up. Well, can you stay healthy? You're always going to have that, especially when it's the little stuff, the knick-knacky stuff. You're out a week, out 2 weeks. Well, maybe he comes back and he just rocks out and plays for a decade straight and yeah. goes to the Hall of Fame, and we just say, look at what we did. Now, I'm not saying that's what he is, but, I mean, when you draft a tackle in the first round, like you're, to your point, is the ceiling is higher. So when you see that elevated level of play, how much higher can he go and push through? Mm-hmm. Can he stay healthy? And the second thing about that is when you have a lower-round pick or undrafted free agent, you see him like a guy like Thielen. He was making game-changing plays in practice against the one defense because he was on the scout team.
Yeah.
And so you're doing against Antoine Winfield.
When he was practice squad guy?
Yeah, you're not playing against the twos and threes. Wow. You're playing against Antoine Winfield,
yeah.
who's the dude, and doing it. And yeah. now you see how it's has changed his career.
That's Chad Greenway, one of the better defensive players in the history of Minnesota Vikings football, courtesy of Gray Duck and Gray Duck Spirits, which has a part of Vikes Bites around the corner. That's a Nordo presentation. It's 9:15 and courtesy of TimberTech and TimberTech.com. What's on Deck 9 to Noon includes more football conversation with Chad Greenway. Thad Levine, general manager for the Minnesota Twins, joins us at 11 o'clock today. And the football feast on a Thursday is in the air. Thank you, TimberTech. Thank you, TimberTech.com. Vikes Bites next.
Have you heard about DraftKings Marketplace? It's the place to snag the latest digital collectibles across sports, entertainment, and culture. DraftKings has released their first ever NFT fantasy game, Rainmakers Football. It's the only NFT fantasy game licensed by the NFLPA. Now you can collect the hottest player card NFTs while playing free for millions in prizes. Right now, everyone can get their first full roster starter pack for free. Playing is simple. Buy, sell, bid, and win player card NFTs of the biggest names in the game through regular drops and auctions on DraftKings Marketplace. Craft lineups of athletes from your NFT collection and earn points for touchdowns, receptions, and more, just like daily fantasy football. Build your NFT franchise and enter free Rainmakers football contests all season long to compete for millions in prizes. Download the DraftKings Daily Fantasy app now and sign up with promo code LOCAL. Click the Rainmakers tile and opt in to get your first full roster starter pack for free. Plus, play for millions in prizes all football season and build the ultimate NFT fantasy franchise with Rainmakers football. That's promo code LOCAL. Build, play, win. Only at DraftKings. Contest entries dependent on type and number of NFTs held. Eligibility restrictions apply. Void where prohibited. See DraftKings.com for details.
I remember booking a canoeing trip on Bear Lake with Viator. I remember my wife's sweet smile taking me back to us canoeing in summer camp. I remember thinking, my oh my, this moment is nothing short of perfect.
I remember turtles.
We all remember things differently. What's important is that they're worth remembering. From canoeing to the Coliseum, you can book it all. Use code Viator10 in the app for 10% off your first booking. Viator, one site, over 300,000 experiences you'll remember.
The Fan.
Womp, bomb, loom, bomb, lomp, bomb, bomb, tootie-boo, oh, woo.
Bikes Bites, provided by
Northern Fire Grilling and Barbecue Supply, north of 62 off Shady Oak in Minnetonka. NorthernFireBBQ.com.
NorthernFireBBQ.com. And speaking of the sizzle that comes with a BBQ, Gray Duck and Gray Duck Spirits has been nice enough to be part of 9 to Noon for many years now. Likewise for Chad Greenway, the face of Grey Duck Vodka and Grey Duck Spirits. The Grey Duck family and the favorite football team family, the Minnesota Vikings, well, they have a partnership at U.S. Bank Stadium.
Hey!
So for the team that aims to leave the adversary punch drunk, we now have Grey Duck Vodka and Spirits at U.S. Bank Stadium. And we have a charity bottle, and we have it available even at Twin Cities Orthopedics Performance Center Monday evening for the night practice. And this is a very, very big move for you guys and for the football team. Congratulations, and tell us more.
Yeah, thank you. It's we've had some meetings early on when in our Grey Duck careers, Grey Duck lives, and you know, we weren't ready yet. And now we're 4 years in. We literally launched this on your show at training camp at TCO. Mm-hmm. Thank you for everything. Mm-hmm. 4 years ago, and now here we are announcing ourselves as the homegrown vodka of the Minnesota Vikings, and to say that as a company, we're so proud. Obviously, we've talked a lot at length about our relationship with the Twins and being at Target Field. This has obviously always been a long-term target for me, and something I'm very proud of, to be able to start a business, be part of a business that has come around, and now be able to support and be a part of, you know, the thing that I'm most known for, is being a Minnesota Viking. So it's incredible. We're so proud of just all of our fans and friends and everything that's supported, and everybody out there that's come around to help us out. And we've talked about this all the time, and we're going to do it again with this bottle. We can't announce exactly what this is going to look like yet, but this charity bottle coming out for the Vikings is going to be elite, and we are so fired up about it. You know, everything we do, we're a for-profit business, but we're in the business of making everybody happy, and we giving back on these charity bottles has been fun. And we're just going to keep going. So our new drink, though, we're going to announce is, you're going to love this, the Nordic Thunder.
Monday night, right?
Monday night. We can sample it at training camp, and that'll kind of be the initial, like, booyah, here it is, ooh, Nordic Thunder, come get it.
Nordo Thunder.
Nordo.
That was my nickname, actually. Yeah, Nordic Thunder. was actually, I was going to get that tattoo. Well, we're not going to go into that. There's no doubt about it.
I thought because when you were a goalie and playing soccer, the lightning was coming at you, but the thunder was able to fend the challenge of the lightning.
Yeah, we'll go with that. That sounds good.
Yeah, this bottle, Nordic Thunder. I think it's great to hearken to when Grey Duck and Grey Duck Spirit started. And this is a startup business, and not all of them win. And then you start up a business, and, you know, then the pandemic hits, and then and we go through what we go through, and here we are, and you push forward. But your biggest piece of joy, what was your, regarding the Grey Duck bottle, what was your biggest piece of joy that you would always share about how cool it is right when these things came out? Because from there to where you are now.
The map on the back?
Unbelievable. I mean, you couldn't stop talking. Look, look, PA, you can look through here and look. Where do you live? Yeah, you'd live right there, but I can't put my finger in the bottle, but it'd be right there.
Yeah, that was great. The map, everybody loved the map, especially me. It's your bottle. You have to love it.
Yeah, so from there to the work with the Grey Duck tent at Twin Cities Summer Jam, to all of the charitable, philanthropic things you guys do, and truly, you know, That is so identifiable, at least to me, with what you and your wife, and then subsequently you and this company, have done through the years. You're always cognizant of benefiting others. And like you said, it's a for-profit business, and you get to make money because you put the money up and you came up with the idea. But what do you do with the money when it starts rolling in?
Right.
Well, you give extravagantly to those who are in need, or those who could use a little help.
Yep.
And you guys are just great with that, man.
Yeah, I appreciate it. It's been fun. It's been a fun 4 years. We're just continuing to push forward, and we're just picking up momentum every day. And that's the fun part. And we think this relationship is going to be very, very fruitful for Grey Duck, but also we want to support the Vikes. We obviously all love them in so many ways, and it's just fun to be a part of that team now.
All right, so lastly, and I'm catching you off guard with this, so if it's a no, I apologize, but like, The first preseason game, August 20th, Niners are here. It's the only home preseason game. Then a couple of weeks later, we play Green Bay on September 11th.
Yep.
So at the Longhouse or on the Plaza, the Nordic Thunder, the move with the Vikings, is it going to be available there?
Yes, I'm pretty sure it's going to be available at the first preseason game. The Grey Duck Bar will be at U.S. Bank Stadium. I can't remember the exact location. I think we're up by the Galahorn.
Oh, you got a great, that's right, Grey Duck Bar in the Palatial Purple Paradise.
Yes, we'll be up there, and then we'll be we're still learning details exactly where we're gonna be, but it's up at the Galahorn. Have not seen it yet, but we'll be built out and we'll be ready. So I'm speaking off the cuff, so I hope it is.
Congratulations, my man.
Thank you very
much. Anything else we need to know? Are we good?
No, we're all good, man. Thanks for the time.
Grey Duck Vodka, Grey Duck Spirits, partnering not only with KFAN, but 9 to noon, and now the Minnesota Vikings, and that's a really good news. Vikes Bites, part two.
Vikes Bites.
What are Patrick Peterson's greatest attributes at this stage of his career, and how does his physical and mental mesh with Ed Donatell's defense?
Chad, take it away.
I think his experience learning a new system. I think in playing in more of a three-back, man-to-man coverage type system, I think he's going to be very good. He's coming out of Zimmer scheme, which is, they're asking to put a lot in the corners. I think he's going to do very well in that. I think his ability to teach these younger guys, along with Harry, is going to be really important.
So when you get to this stage of your career, and you played with Winfield near the end of his career, and granted, they're different players, but they're still the same because they're corners, and, Antoine played inside a fair amount, if not all, at the end of his career.
Or how about Terrence Newman, who was like 50 years old, still trying to get out there and make plays?
Yep. Great example, because Terrence would play on the outside.
Yep.
When you're a corner and you're not as fast as you used to be, and Patrick had some 4.2 to him when he came into the league like 11 years ago from LSU. When it comes to the cunning and guile and the craft, what do you think are some keys for a corner who can't run with a 4.3 guy anymore, but he can still stop him because he's smart?
Yeah, you get ahead of the game. I mean, Antoine would literally watch film until the minute we left the locker room, He would come back in at halftime. He would watch film at halftime.
Of the first half?
No, of the opponent he's going against from weeks before.
Yeah.
And what he's looking at is just tells. Where in his alignment, in his feet, how he's setting up, where's he looking, what's the quarterback communicating to that receiver, you know, with hand signals. And he's jumping routes and not jumping routes in a way to take a risk, but jumping routes in order to help himself add a step to his speed. And no different than playing linebacker. The older in the tooth you get, a little slower, you have to take advantage of somewhere else. And it's your experience. It's your smarts. It's finding the angle, taking a step earlier, just knowing what's coming, expectation. And Tuan was great at that, and that's what he'll be as well, Pat.
Winfield, arguably the greatest corner in the history of this football team.
You got too many men out there.
Vikes Bites.
Picture yourself slamming some Nordic Thunder while smoking a pork butt.
Call me Nordo Thunder, honey. Yeah.
With a grill you got at Northern Fire Grilling and Barbecue Supply in Minnetonka, which brings you Vikes Bites. Which learning curve is shorter? Adam Thielen learning the multiples of a new offense. Or our guy Eric Kendricks learning the new defense?
Both
smart guys. I'm going to go with Thielen. I got a feeling, because I think Kendricks, it's actually going to simplify Kendricks' role. I think his is going to be more physical. Can he hold up? Can he get off blocks? Can he get off these big guards? Are going to get up on him when he's not, you know, the guy in front of him, not even one technique. You have guards uncovered. You have ends outside. So those guards can get up to EK quick. He's a freak athlete. He's super fast. He's physically strong, little undersized, people would say, but that hasn't held him back to this point. I've seen EK get off blocks. I know he can do it. I like his chances, but I would say learning curve would go to Thielen.
And I would agree off a chat we had with him yesterday in the opening segment, at Twin Cities Orthopedics Performance Center, because I've chatted either on or off the mic with Adam Thielen hundreds of times. And this is the first time when the question was posed to him about the complexity of learning this offense. And I went down the road of how much Rams all 22 from 2021 do you watch to learn this? And he said, well, in the early stages of OTAs, we watched a ton.
Yep.
Because even though the play is going to be called something different and it will have a twist to it, here's what it is.
Yep.
So here's depth of route guy. Cooper Kupp, Robert Woods, both very good with depth of route. And you know, Adam just kind of, his eyes just kind of went up like, it's hard. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is a hard system to learn. But when we get it down, hide the women and children.
Let's go.
Because this is a wonderful, wonderful piece of deception that is there week in and week out, they believe, with each play.
Does it feel like we're talking as if, and this is kind of similar to going from Zimmer to Kevin O'Connell, where we're speaking of this offense in some ways as if we're going from the Stone Age to the Space Age? Like, we're so excited about it. It's so new. And even having Kendricks on the perch with Common yesterday, one thing he mentioned is one of the parts that's exciting about him and for him learning the new defense is he's also seeing a ton of new looks offensively.
Yep.
But ultimately, how much more complex or difficult is it for a defense? Like, from the Kubiak offense to this McVay / O'Connell bit, is it Stone Age to Space Age? Because guys like Kubiak have had a ton of success in their careers, too.
Right.
Yeah, I think that it's you're going to learn a lot more intricacies in routes, in depths, in alignments, in the offensive side. Defensively, you know, in the base 3-4, it's going to be line up. Here's our techniques. We're going to play fundamental coverage behind it. Mm-hmm. Now, the complexity of the coverage, I don't know that you'll get more complex than what Zim was doing.
Right.
He may. I don't know him well enough to know, but I know Zim's was complex.
Yep.
And combination coverages, rolling people over the top, you know, half zone, half man, a lot of fun stuff. And I think from the cover standpoint, which EK is elite at anyways, my hope is he gets freed up to look at the quarterback more and to read, because that's what he is very, very good at. And obviously, you have to mix in man coverage as well. But I think it's harder offensively than it will be defensively. And I think that's why I think EK is going to be more physical than mental.
Not everybody has a tree. Not everybody is a tree. Like, you have the Bill Walsh tree.
Right.
You got a Belichick tree. You have a Parcells tree. I mean, you only are a tree if you are able to be respected, deeply rooted, and fend all of the metaphorical wind and hurricanes and tornadoes and rain and just over the course of many, many years.
Yep.
So Parcells is a tree, and Zimmer is a limb on Parcells' tree. So therefore, the complexity and things you're going to pull from Bill is are going to work and they're going to be well respected. Well, McVay, the McVay tree is, I mean, it's not, you know,
it's 5 years old.
Right. It's still growing.
It's a sapling.
But yeah. O'Connell, well, it's more than a sapling when you go to the Super Bowl twice and you win one of them. So this,
it's a gold sapling. Yeah,
this thing, it's got some oak to it.
Growing quickly.
Very difficult to move. And O'Connell's a limb on that tree. And that's good because you're going to get things that are super well respected. McVay is HOF bound, depending on how long he stays in the league. I mean, he's been a head coach, what, 6 years? Been to two Super Bowls.
Yep. Hello.
Not bad.
So O'Connell, being a limb on that tree, you know, now the limb needs to grow and establish its identity. And I think that's just beautiful.
Yeah. Just wrinkles.
Vikes Bites.
How about this? Anthony Barr gets a one-year deal with the Cowboys. Good to see him catch on with the new squad. Not necessarily happy that it's Dallas in particular. But all the same, love Anthony Barr. You played a bunch with him. You know him well. Chad, your thoughts?
Very happy, proud, always proud of AB. I'm glad he found a home. One-year deal, kind of a could be a prove-it deal to extend his career.
Right.
And it could be an awesome opportunity to go out there and prove, you know, in Dallas, which we all know what, you know, as a Cowboy, you're put on a massive pedestal and given a massive opportunity in front of a national audience a lot. Mm-hmm. And, you know, what AB, as he came in and what we saw him do and accomplish here was awesome to watch. I wish he was still here. It's not the case, but I will cheer for him wherever he goes.
It's kind of funny because locally over the course of time, a lot of people have always asked, what does Anthony Barr do? He doesn't splash enough. There's always been kind of up and down conversations and related to Anthony. Nationally, they're like, holy bleep, what a steal. Can't wait to see him with the Cowboys. There's almost less appreciation in some ways for what he gave us here than what those on the outside are looking in and saying, man, we could use that on our defense.
Yeah, I think it goes back to if you're not the splash guy who's sacking the quarterback 15 times a year, you're going to be like, why aren't you doing more? And I take it back to, you know, AB made a ton of plays. He's so versatile within a defense to be able to do multiple things with his size, to be able to rush, cover, you know, all the things he can do at his size is crazy.
Long-ass arms.
So I think you underappreciate a guy when he's here. And then you realize how he's valued elsewhere. Now, he may go to Dallas, and he may end up being the same player there. Or he may find a different role and absolutely kill it and go for 15 this year, and we'll all be,
Yeah.
But you know, either way, chill dude, great guy, wishing nothing but the best.
His pass coverage and his drops in the Tampa 2, or in pass coverage, always super well-respected.
He's so big.
Unless you're in Buffalo.
Hey. Come on now.
And here comes Chad.
Just two yards deeper. So all he needed was two more yards.
Well, that was the secret sauce.
Well, this is the perfect time to bring this up. The fourth and, was it 20?
Whatever.
Yeah, of because
Scott Chandler,
because every, and that had to be my college teammate, too. Every year in training camp, about this time, we're going through situations, and it would literally be the Greenway situation on fourth and 20. Then I would look at Zimmer and blame him, you know, at the practice and be like, why didn't you take a timeout?
Yeah.
Because we couldn't get McKenzie lined up, and here we are.
And you're running up to the line.
Yeah, trying to get guys lined up.
Walking more elegantly and quickly than Michael Jackson ever did.
Zimmer's yelling at me in my headset. You have him yelling at me. McKenzie getting lined up. We're fourth and 20. Trying to drop my coverage. Yeah. AB short on his drop.
Yeah.
And I get blamed.
Right.
And of course, he's a young guy.
And the other Anthony Barr story, and I shared it yesterday, was very early in his career. It was the season he stole the ball from Austin Seferian Jenkins.
That's so his rookie good. Season.
In so Tampa good. Along the sideline and walked off a winner. Well, at the college stadium, you guys played the Atlanta Falcons. Mm-hmm. And Mike Tice was either the O-line coach or the offensive coordinator, one of the two for the Falcons. And they lost like three offensive linemen in like one quarter. So they're using obscure tight end Levine Toilolo as the tackle trying to win the game. And they're just fighting tooth and nail with you guys. But there was a play in the game that identified Anthony Barr to offensive coordinators involving fullback Patrick DeMarco.
Yep.
Because they ran a lead play.
Mistake.
With like Freeman or somebody. And what Barr did to DeMarco to blow the play up, it's like all offensive coordinators, from what I understand after that, was like, all right, well, the fullback at 55 ain't going to work, so let's start getting deeper in the playbook.
Yeah, where's Greenway? It's running at him. Yeah, because AB would do to fullbacks what every linebacker wished they could do all the time. Yeah. He would just do it because that's just what he did. And we're like, what? And he was known as not the physical guy coming out, but he could be absolutely just a physical beast.
Yeah, good for Anthony. I hope he makes it.
Yep.
Vikes Bites.
Northern Fire Grilling and Barbecue Supply. One last one for you gentlemen. Special teams coordinator Matt Daniels said this about Greg Joseph. I'll put it on record now and say I firmly believe Greg Joseph will have his best year in his career this year.
Come on.
I'll put it out there right now. I'm sure of it. The way he finished up the summer, the way he prepared, how he's come back and hit the football is the best I've seen him. I've only been around him 4 or 5 months, but he's missed 2 kicks out of 35 kicks that he had in the 3 sessions that we've had together.
Wow.
Has he gone to the Vikings Museum and just looked back at history?
Well, here's the thing, though. Joseph goes out, and he was perfect, 8 of 8 in practice, including one from nearly 60.
In where? Practice?
At TCO, yes.
Okay.
Well, hey, here's the deal. Warm fuzzies. It's been a while since somebody said something nice about the kicker, and he goes out and pays you off, at least for one day. Is there a coincidence? Warm fuzzies and successful kicking. Does it mix in Minnesota?
Yeah. Well, it's another option. Let's try this option. Let's see if this one works.
We tried everything else.
I just don't think there's any fan out there listening right now that believes anything that we're... It's a prove-it deal.
They got to see it with the kicker.
You got to see it with the kicker. We've seen the L's we've taken on wide left.
Yeah, the P in PTSD with this conversation is purple. Yeah. And it involves kickers. Yep. And if Vikings fans are like, okay, well, that sounds great, and hopefully things work out well... But there's zero chance I get over the hump on a kicker for the Minnesota Vikings until he's splitting the uprights and we're walking off Super Bowl champions.
Yes, amen.
And then even after that, it's still probably in a habit state would, you know, be difficult for people to get over the hump. But that, you know, you don't hear that often from coordinators, period, let alone this time of the year, where somebody comes out and stamps it saying,
that's what I'm worried about.
Go ahead and put this in print. on radio and or TV, this is going to happen. It will be the best season of his career, because I thought Greg was pretty good last year.
Yeah, different approach.
37-yard try to win the game. Andrew DePaula snaps, Jordan Berry holds.
What are we doing here?
High snap, put down. Joseph, come on! It is gone! No, he missed it!
Good.
Are you kidding me? He missed it right.
He missed it right.
Oh, my heavens.
Oh,
Nordo.
Oh, my. This.
You missed it right.
Nordo's.
Where's the Chandler highlight? To balance things.
Nordo's my lunch today.
I was feverishly trying to find it. It must have expired in the system. I'm good at usually having that one under my thumb when Chad's in.
Oh. But see, Daniel's the new special teams coordinator. He's in a can't lose situation. Because if Joseph has the best season of his career,
he wins.
Look what I said.
Yep.
But nobody's going to remember the special teams coordinator said this early in August about Greg Joseph and then like quote tweet it. Nice call.
unless he's held accountable for that, because he didn't have a good season because of the coach.
Right. That's Chad Greenway. Once again, a big announcement earlier. Grey Duck Vodka and Grey Duck Spirits have teamed with the Minnesota Vikings. There's going to be a Grey Duck, do we call it a bar?
Bar.
Yeah, Grey Duck Bar at U.S. Bank Stadium. And also Monday for the night practice. You will be able to sample Nordic Thunder. That's a new drink from the Grey Duck people. Very charitable and philanthropic as they are. A final segment with 5-2 when 9 to noon continues. We'll discuss some more Vikings football with Chad Greenway at FM 100.3 KFAN.
The Fan.
Remember those super hot days down Fancato way, where like with those days where the temp gets up to around 100 and there's been humidity this week too, when those days, and you pushed through many of those days, were you or do you get the feeling the players are miserable during practice during those times, or once you get out there and you start running around and doing your thing, is it where you kind of forget about it or what?
Combination. Depends on where you're at in training camp. You're miserable. The warm up, the walk out, the warm up and the individual period that gets you moving is miserable.
Yeah.
And then once you get into football and you're learning something new, you're applying something from the classroom, it gets to be more fun.
Yep.
And it gets to be a little bit, you know, you're watching, you're listening. But those hot, muggy, humid days, you know, and we complain, but, you know, try going to Louisiana or someplace in the South, right, and deal with this humidity.
Right.
We have it pretty lucky, but there'd be days when it's just a grind. And there's other days when, you know, that's why the camaraderie, that locker room of, you know, inside jokes and, you know, just carrying through the day. And, you know, when you go through the periods of the practice, 10-minute period for individual. Okay, boom, we knocked that one out. It's like on the next. You have like 9-10 periods. You're just knocking them out one after the other, mm-hmm. you know, going through practice and learning, understanding, making mistakes, making plays. And then when it gets into the team periods, it's fun because now your whole group's there. It's defense versus offense. It's excitable. People are fired up, want to win, you know, and it's the highest level of competition and you're fighting for your job while cheering for the people that are fighting for your job.
Right.
So it's just a weird kind of dynamic, but
big
man,
time.
there's moments when, you know, obviously you're making money, you're doing all that, which is great, but it is a grinder.
Right. Nordo and I were discussing this the last couple of days and it's annual for me because I forget about it up to training camp. But the weird facet of it is, oh, wow, what a great move by Amir Smith-Marset, toe-tapping the boundary, brought it in for 17, and here we go. Well, what was Dantzler doing?
Yep.
I mean, was he late? Right. Did he get burned, or was the safety late?
Yep.
And then, like, you go to another play, holy cow, did Dalvin set up that screen beautifully. What was Zadarius doing? I mean, was it a bad angle? Or I mean, you know what I'm saying?
It's just back and forth. You turn the film on, yeah.
It's almost, now you can have perfection on both sides. Play worked beautifully. Dalvin got 7. Cam Bynum came flying in to keep it at 7.
Yep.
So the more of those you see,
the better it is.
The more pleasurable things are.
Yes.
But sometimes there are big plays. Crowd's going nuts and everything with like Zach Davidson, the second year tight end over the middle. Say he's running some type of post in the middle of the field. Ooh, that's cool, man. Look at him go. Well, great. I mean, who fell down?
Yeah, where's the backer?
Somebody fell down. Okay. And if you're on the ground in the National Football League, you're sooner or later going to go from on the ground to on the street.
Yep. So, you're right about that.
I mean, we're going nuts over Zach Davidson, but what about this L right here?
Yep.
I mean, that could be a problem too.
I think the one thing you can't, as a player, you can't tell a fan is what it feels like about 8 days into camp when you're about four full pad practices in, what your body feels like when you wake up the next morning and your feet up to your knees, up to your, you know, ankles to knees to hips. Then you got to throw the pads back on because here we go again. Warm ups at 9 a.m.
Yeah.
Individuals at 9:20. You know, you're doing 9-on-7 hitting at 9:40 and you better wake up and get going.
See, that's been one eye-opening thing to me with O'Connell, Kwesi Adofo-Mensah, Ryan Grigson, and the rest of the constituents with the way they've changed the timing of things.
Yeah.
So I believe the kids are getting there later. The walkthrough is, well, part of it's virtual, which is fascinating and brilliant. And then they get out there for just like 45 minutes in the walkthrough. Then they chill for 30 minutes, maybe 45. Then they practice.
Wow.
And I like that because the retention from the walkthrough, we don't have a 3-hour gap, you know, with phones and conversing and lunch and stuff like that. That's all handled. Now, I do believe they are there later, you know, where like specifically on Thursdays, man, later in the season when the practice gets moved back to like 11 a.m. or whatever. I get over there to do some work, and a lot of you guys are jumping out to your cars and leaving.
Yep.
Well, that may be the case as the season goes on, but in looking at the schedule, things are going later. There are meetings, honestly, the latest I've ever seen in my work with the team. And what I like about that is because I'm not going to say you got to be cognizant with every player and every team of like when you leave here, let's be safe. Let's be smart.
Yep.
But you're also minimizing life outside of the facility when you leave.
Yep.
And when you go from the walkthrough to the practice and you only have 45 minutes and the retention of the plays and everything, that just feels like it's going to lead to sharpness.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's a great way to look at it. I think for us, our last, when we're in Mankato, our last meeting would end at 9:15.
In the
evening? Yeah, so we would go all the way till 9:15, and we'd be done. And what you're doing from 7 yeah. is team meeting, 7:20 is defensive meeting.
Well, then you watch change then.
Yeah, because then you're watching film. That's training camp schedule. Once we come back, it changes. Once we come back to Winter Park, then we'd be done at 5, 6 o'clock. It'd be like a normal work day.
Yeah.
But when you're Mankato, when you're all in, you know, wake up at 7, lifting, into the walkthrough, into meetings, into lunch, into meetings, into practice, into meetings. You know, it's a full day done at 9:15, have a snack, go to bed, do it again. And but it's so much film watch. So like you're practicing at 5 o'clock, you're done at 6:30, or you're practicing at 4 o'clock, you're done at 6:30.
Yeah.
You're eating, you're coming back, now you're watching that practice all night. You wake up the next morning, you lift, you watch the rest of that practice, you install, then you walk through, and it's just a cyclical, you know, all day is football nonstop, and so this mode they're in right now is the grinder full day football. In about another week and a half, 2 weeks, they'll transition more to like a regular in season schedule. Be done five or six o'clock and have a little more personal time at night.
Okay, give me your best 30 seconds on each of these topics.
From the freezers to the geezers.
If there was one identifiable thing from the offense, like say last season, to what you would like to see different this season, what would it be?
Dalvin catching the ball more. Yeah, from out of the backfield. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, he's still got 27 seconds. Hold on.
From another close L to hotter than hell.
same with the defense. One identifiable thing that you would like to see that was like it's with the defense in the last couple of years, there were some numbers and some stats that dramatically fell off. Now, in no way is this being a Zimmer apologist, because his career is accomplished. He has a Super Bowl ring, and he's one of the more respected defensive coordinators in the history of the NFL. The personnel the last couple of years, when you're losing to Neal and you're losing Anthony, and you got Cordarea Tankersley and Chris Jones running around in the secondary, you ain't going to beat anybody. But nevertheless, just take the way you know this defense run with the right personnel. Yet you still would like to see one thing identifiably change. What would it be?
Well, do I state the obvious and just go pass rush?
That's
what I'm looking at. Is this league right now, when you're playing nickel 75% to 80% of the time, and they're throwing the ball the way they are, especially in our division with the guy in Green Bay, is you got to rush the passer and do it consistently. And you know, I'm going to talk about coming from the outside, but can our guys in the interior get enough center push? Can they hold up the middle to let our guys? Can we stay healthy on the outside and get a pass rush? Because now we're going, you know, in our third down stuff, we're going to a four down alignment with your two backers. We know we can cover in the middle of the defense with Eric. Can we get that pass rush to take this defense and make the back end better with our pass rush? Because if you have that, your back end looks really good. Tip balls and interceptions because the ball's coming out too early. So that to me, it's all pass rush.
From Nordo Thunder to your back end looking really good. What a wonderful hour that was. Congratulations on a Grey Duck partnering with the Vikings.
Yes.
Thank you for everything you've done for the radio show and KFAM. And I look forward to seeing you next time. All right.
You bet. Thanks.
Chad Greenway.
Set sail for Glendale.
9 to noon, and when we return, speaking of Vikings head coach Kevin O'Connell, some thoughts from his press conference he conducted yesterday. We will share those around the corner.